Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the brand new episode of Fireside Chat with Misha Ahmed. Welcome to the brand new episode of Fireside Chat with Misha Ahmed on CXO Global TV. CXO Global Forum is a knowledge sharing platform which involves our influencers who are heads and VPs of large companies, as these people would no doubt have made massive changes in their working arena. Our aim is to get global exposure regarding digital transformation and innovation around the globe. However, it's an honor for us in contributing to the world of knowledge economy. So today we have Mr. Mohammed Shahid Siddiqui with us, who is the head of customer services and head of technology development at Centigy Technologies Private Limited. Sir, thank you for joining us.
Welcome, and thanks for giving us a chance.
Thank you so much, sir, that you gave us your precious time. Sir, first of all, I would like to ask you what would you like to tell us about your role at Centigy Technologies?
Yeah. As Centigy Technologies, many of us know, is a company that markets their products across the globe in two or three sectors: retail, insurance, and a few others. So because we are marketing our ready-made products, so one of key areas of services is to provide implementation and support services to our customers so that their experience with our products remains smooth and adds value to their business. So as a head of customer services, my role is to lead our project rollouts, implementation, and post go live support functions for our products.
Right. Sir, as you told us that you provide services for the customers. So I would like to ask you that, will you please let us know that what basically customer services are?
Yeah. For me, it was a single line when I started working in this area, because primarily I'm a tech guy. So I have been with a technology background because I'm an engineer. I started as a software engineer, and also I had been working as an infra and hardware consultant. So when we are in technology, we are always right, because we think that we, the IT guys, what we are suggesting as best practices is the right approach. But obviously, when you come in customer services, then the first and foremost lesson is that the customer is always right. As customer services, our business is to support them in such a way that our products and our services or offerings add value to their businesses. Even if we have a technology that is comparable to NASA at technical level, but obviously it is of zero value if it is not again adding value to customers' business. So the implementations and the product configurations and the usage should be aligned such a way that the customer gets a genuine value from out of that product. Until they're not getting a genuine value out of that product, obviously you are always at risk in your business. So this is our primary job, that we provide our services in such a way that the customer has a genuine and tangible value being added to their business and their growth. So this is how I look to customer services.
Okay, right. Sir, as you told us that you have been in the field of technology from the beginning. So, sir, I would like to ask you that, were you part of Unilever from the beginning, or were you part of some other company before?
So our journey has been quite interesting. Since start, I am part of the same team since start of my career. But alhamdulillah, we have grown to such a level that now we are a large group of companies, and rather we have distributed to various group of companies which are now acting independently in various service and product areas. So I have been serving to Unilever as a consultant and have been part of their team, but only on behalf of my employer. So we were part of a consulting company called Siddharth Heather, which had business of management consultancy and also chartered accountants. So we were a part of a small team within that consulting company. At that time, we used to provide consulting services and customized development to our customers. But gradually, we discovered ideas where we could come up with our products. And then there was a, you know, if you have a few minutes, then I had some interesting aspects other than technology and profession and business. Some of our directors, they are very patriotic even in their daily life and in their professional life. For example, they are not always comfortable in being reseller of foreign products into Pakistan because they think that this way they can get some easy bucks, but obviously they are not serving their countries in a long run in terms of bringing country on their own revenue generating sources and bringing company on a self-sustaining path. So they were always working to develop their own products, which they can market across the globe and be a flag bearer of Pakistan over there. And alhamdulillah, we have been successful in that. And we have our products across the globe. In Africa, we are in some of their major economies with their major brands in Southeast Asia, in South Asia, and in Middle East. And alhamdulillah, in one of our roadmaps, we are going to roll out our product to 50 countries with a single customer, with a single brand. Alhamdulillah. So this has been quite a quite an interesting journey. So now I'm part of Centigy Retail Solutions that works on retail products and retail solutions.
Right, sir. That was very good to know. Sir, as you told us that you've been part of this company since so long. So I would I would like to know that have you ever faced any challenges in this great cause?
Yes, obviously. Both at individual level and both at and also at organization level, we have been through as an organization, we have been through a number of crises that the country has been through. For example, there was an trade embargo applied on us on Pakistan in late 90s when we did our nuclear experiment. That was quite a tough time, and also the global recession, and then because Dubai is our market, one of our key markets. So obviously, when Dubai faced a downturn, obviously we had the impacts out of that. And now the COVID. So obviously, we have been through these 4 or 5 crises. But alhamdulillah, because we have a team that is a family culture. So we stand with each other in those tough moments. There were times I can remember. When I think that was the trade embargo posed in Pakistan. At that time, my team didn't have any business for 6 months. But our employees never asked us that why you were sitting here when you are not doing any business. They used to take their salaries up after all of their employees had got their salaries. So, and in your company, the trend is that if because of any reason, for example, if there is a forex challenge, if there is any if due to COVID or any other reason, if there is a delay of 2, 3, 4 days in collection, and so first of all, the peon, the office boys, the lower staff, the junior programmers, the young engineers, they get the same, and management gets after them, and leadership on the last. So this has been keeping us together because we trust each other. We have a family culture. So this is how we cope with those challenges.
Right, so that's very good to know that you have this kind of very friendly environment at your company. So, as you mentioned about the pandemic, that's COVID pandemic, which is currently also going on. So, I would like to know that how did you manage to, manage to take up things during this pandemic when it hit early in the beginning?
Yeah, so obviously it has been a tough time, and everyone was their own challenges to cope up with. We were lucky on one part that we do business with retail, and some of our senior colleagues were able to discover the potential of retail and the sustainability that is associated with food and retail sector, because these are the products and areas in which you cannot stop business. Even in very tough times, even during the wars, you find out windows when you have to get ceasefire so that supplies can reach to the masses. So these are the businesses which which are, you know, have to be carried out. Everyone knows that you have to keep a window open for these messages. So this is one thing. Alhamdulillah, we were able to increase, diversify our portfolio to retail before this pandemic. And the second, there were certain areas in which we were facing challenges, which actually got impacted during pandemic. But obviously, you cannot avoid these challenges. So we try to find out the opportunities out of this pandemic. For example, e-commerce, for example, B2B, for example, B2C, these have immense potentials. And even the very biased deniers and no-sayers cannot deny the value of e-commerce, the value of B2B, the value of B2C now. Everyone has been using the RAS and Foodpanda and so many services during these days. So this actually opened up a number of opportunities for us. And some products which were actually in a longer roadmap, we expedited the roadmap and utilized it as an opportunity. We got a number of new leads in certain products. We actually pushed some products which were targeted for probably 2022, but we expedited them in 2020. So, and we got interest from the market, a good feedback from the market, and we are rolling them out from there.
Right, sir. That's very good to know that you keep these things quite smoothly, even in the pandemic. So, sir, as you've been part of technology and you're now, in it as well. So, I would like to know that how do you see the future of technology or this tech world in the current times, and how do you see these things going on?
Yeah. You see, the society in next, I think, the next couple of decades, I think, is going to be very highly technology centric. You know, computer technology. I remember when I started using my first computer, Commodore C64, back in 80s, in my when I was in school at my uncle's home. At that time, you had to actually explain it to everyone what is computer and what is technology. Then there came a time when people got familiarity to a certain level. They started seeing them in banks, in their offices, in their accounts office, probably as their ATM outlet. But now you see, everyone is technology centric. We know this revolution has already happened because as a consumer and also as a vendor. You see, there are a number of online application and online solutions. There was a time then even the MNCs were reluctant to roll them out in Asian countries, saying that this may be premature to roll them out now because people don't have connectivity, don't have infrastructure. But now, when they have seen that there are TikTok channels, there are YouTube channels being driven from small villages of Sindh and Punjab and other provinces and having probably 0.8 million subscribers, obviously, everyone knows the technology has gone ahead. So now it is our turn to actually build and sell platforms on top of that and solutions on top of that. And I think Pakistan has been quite lucky. Blessing in disguise, we don't have a lot of regulations on e-commerce. This is not an ideal scenario. But this has actually kept the red tape out, unlike some of our neighboring countries, which for the right reasons have a lot of regulations, and they should have, even we should have those regulations in the longer run. But because initially it has put a red tape on them, so we had been lucky that they were our technology vendors were able to actually experiment, able to try so many technologies, and many of them started running and generated a lot of business and interest. And as you can see that I just checked my LinkedIn stream of job ads. So many startups coming out every week, particularly from Lahore, and also many of them from Karachi and Islamabad and other cities, even from some smaller cities. Faisalabad is doing a lot of things behind the curtain. I know because I have some small competitors growing out of Faisalabad and Multan and cities like this, which we had never thought of getting competition from those towns. So this is healthy. So I think as a country, it's healthy for us. We are getting new experiments, new startups. Although there is a lot of areas of improvement to actually help them grow, help them sustain, and provide them an ecosystem in which they can grow more at a faster scale. Still, this is a good sign. Then globally, you see, now technology is everywhere. You know, when you hear that people selling out their shares in oil, probably in large pharmaceuticals, in large MNCs, and buying shares in technology companies, and technology companies have the largest growth rate globally. Obviously, you know, a revolution has happened. So this is going to provide so many opportunities for people to grow, to have jobs, new businesses. At the same time, actually, states have to be very careful on the privacy side, because obviously this is going to, because people have ideas, people have energies, and they will invest and they will grow in every direction, every possible direction. So the governments and authorities have to be very careful on that. And on that part, I think Pakistanis are, as a nation, we are far behind, far, far behind. We know from Indian stories and other stories that we were being targeted through Pegasus or some other scandals, but we don't have proper legislation, we don't have proper muscle to handle them, and this is scaring actually.
Right, so that's very interesting and informative as well for me to know all these changes that have been coming out in the tech world. So, sir, I would like to know that what message you like to give to the startups and those who are coming into this world.
Yeah, I think one very important thing is that still the startups, those are tagged with their countries and their nations. So we are coming up with some very good ideas, with some very good startups, but we have to be very careful that trust. We have to actually maintain the trust of consumers and customers. Let me give an example. I was doing, I had launched mobility products a couple of years back. And because I have grown in my organization with some very strict guys who are very strict on the trust side and confidentiality side. So for me, that was something new. In one of the events in UAE, we were offered to give our customer contacts data at a very high cost. They asked us to provide the whole bank's data to them, and they will pay us one dirham for every contact. And there were, you know, those were not hundreds or thousands of contacts. So for me, this was something new. I had never heard, but obviously we told them very clearly they should not expect anything like this from us. And alhamdulillah, in these last 25 years of our team, alhamdulillah, we might have been shortcomings in sometimes in some part of services or some of our customers, but we have never got any complaint of breaching their trust. So this is something we have to be very careful. If something goes wrong, it will be labeled as a Pakistani startup did this and did that. I don't need to school them on their energies. They have a lot of energies. They have a lot of ideas, much better than, fresher than, younger than myself. But as a brand, we have to be very careful for brand Pakistan. Second, we need to think larger, bigger. You see, as a startup, it's very attractive to get an offer of probably $500,000 and sell the startup in very early stages. But we have been doing a lot of such startups and sell-offs from Pakistan. If you just check the startup news, you will find so many startups with so many potentials and promises, but they just vanish with a sell-off in very early stages. But we have to think big to grow to a global scale.
Right.
So this is something I think I would, instead of advising, I would request them to think big and to maintain the trust of customers. Inshallah, we'll grow as a brand.
Right, so thank you so much for all this very good and impressive message that you gave to the new startups. And with that, I would like to end our session. I hope that our viewers have learned so much from our session, and they might have now start to think big before entering this world. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for your time.
Thanks a lot.
Take care and allow this.
Love is.